Hello, everybody. It is 10:01 p.m. Central Time on Thursday, the 16th of March, 2017. And welcome into the Earthquake 3D live stream, where we daily recap seismic events from around the planet. And we also issue semi-daily and weekly earthquake forecasts for new areas to watch for movement. And it looks like we're starting out. I don't know if this is an accurate count on my stream or not. My counter seems to be messed up, but looks like we got several hundred people between YouTube and Twitch and Facebook and my website. So it's really good to see everybody in here tonight. Let me just start off really quick by saying a big, big thank you. Huge thank you to everybody who's decided to donate to my fundraiser. And I showed what I've made this month on YouTube, in case you guys missed it, $200 for the whole month on YouTube. They completely cut me off. And everybody has responded. This is in 4 hours' time. I've reached over half of the goal. And this is to get me through to mid-summer, guys. So I'm not looking to take vacations or buy nice clothes or anything. This is solely to pay the bills and keep me here for the rest of the year, going into 2018. And it's already been a year since that big fundraiser last year. To get me through till this year. So I really appreciate everybody that's helped. And we're keeping it minimum. I'm trying to keep it down to the bare minimum of what I would need just to pay the rent and pay the bills. And I have a choice. This summer, I have a choice. I can go back into tree cutting and carpentry. I could take jobs, and it means I wouldn't be here during the day. And at night, I'd be tired, probably not doing updates as much as I would normally. Of course, if I'm here full-time as a job online. So I got a choice. We'll put that choice back to the viewers again this year, come summertime. So we got several more months to go, and I really appreciate everybody who's helped. Also, really quick, another update. I've started an account over on Steemit. So if you guys haven't been to Steemit before, you should come over and check it out. It's a blockchain. So what it is you make a post there, and it posts like a website. And let's click on it, show it to you here. And you can click on it, watch the YouTube embed, see my little post here with my links. And this goes in a blockchain with thousands of other posts, and there's no way to take it down. In order for somebody to take down my post, they'd have to take down thousands of other posts as well at the same time or more. And then people are paying in Bitcoin. If they like my stuff, they can buy 1 cent each time you click something. It goes up 1 cent on a Bitcoin, and you could start getting paid. I mean, it's just something really cool, and you also can get paid for your comments and stuff, guys. Okay. So check it out. Just go check out Steemit if you want to check that out. That's really cool to see. So check out my Facebook when you get a chance to do that. Okay, those are the updates. Let's get into the earthquakes that struck since last night. Now we need to look at the largest earthquake over here in the East Pacific to get an idea of what struck, and take a look at it, guys. Marked here in white is our 5.2 earthquake. And let me get it on the screen so all the others are gone. And you'll see it. We warned it for it last night. And today, here it is, a mid-range 5 striking in Colombia after several weeks without any 5.0 activity at all. And that's expected based upon what was coming around the plate. So check Colombia off the list. Colombia, a direct earthquake forecast hit and magnitude hit and location hit. Same time that happened, down to the south, we saw new eruptions at Sabancaya, and in between the eruptions, two sets of fours breaking out on either side of the volcano, guys. So now there's some serious movement happening, and these are fairly shallow. I mean, they're not terribly deep. Let me just call it that way. So they're happening on both sides of the volcano, and then the volcano blew a flight level 200, which is a 20,000-foot high blast. Additionally, down to the south, a single 4 struck south of Nevados del Chilean volcano. Nevados del Chilean sending off more blasts today, and that's where the red arrow comes across. Let me show that to you, where the red arrow says travels underneath and where it meets back up just north of the earthquake here. So that spot being struck as well. And then we need to jump over to the West Pacific. Take a look at this down here at New Zealand, a new swarm of earthquakes topping out at 5.0, then a 4 downgraded to 3.7 struck down here at just north of Wellington, pretty close to the red line. But this is kind of a little bit different, not slightly different, but it is the north part of the island near the Kermadec being struck, and also over to the west at our triangular bend in the Solomon Islands, between Papua New Guinea and the Solomon Islands, directly in the middle of the warned location. We see a swarm of fours and a 5.1 topping out. So really, if you look at it this way, a swarm of fours or a couple fours and a five, and a swarm of fours or a couple fours and a five on both sides of the letter D. And that goes back to our previous deep earthquake from a day ago, which was also a 5.1. So we're seeing similar sized movement now happen on both sides of our letter D. That's a dramatic change. This is actually a change that we're seeing happen here, and I've noticed it over the past several weeks, and I think longtime viewers will also start to notice that when we're seeing deep earthquakes here where our letter D is, the turnaround earthquakes are becoming less and less powerful. Have you guys noticed that? I'm not the only one that's noticed that. Surely you guys have noticed that when these deep earthquakes are striking, the deep fours, deep fives, and deep sixes, it's only resulting in fives and sixes. It's not resulting in these larger earthquakes. Now that's a change. That is a dramatic change from where things were. Now it could be that's just a temporary thing happening. It could be that it's a new development. With these deep earthquakes, we don't know what to expect because we haven't seen them happen in swarms like this before, at least in the last 7 years that I've been watching. So these new deep earthquakes are kind of like a recent development over the past year or 2 years. The swarms of deep earthquakes, I mean. Now the locations haven't changed. The locations where the deep earthquakes occur, that has remained relatively the same over the past 7 years. But the frequency, the number of them, has dramatically increased. But now it seems that they're not having as much of an effect. Maybe it's already pushed up on the underside of the plate as far as it can go. Maybe there's something else at play here. Okay, so just understand, both sides of the letter D struck. This means down in New Zealand, we need to watch to the south of the island. Since the north part of the island was struck, and the central part of the island was struck by a 4 or a 3.7, if we look at all the smaller earthquakes, let's just quickly look at that. You'll see over the past couple days, of course, we have our progression line. It's standing out as obvious yet once again. It almost looked like, if you were to connect this across to the red line down to the south, it would look almost like a, let me turn on my display capture here so you guys can see my mouse. It would look almost like an eyeball shape that you were drawing. So something's going on here where there's a connecting that's happening between the south part of the island, where the red line is, and going up here to the north, and it's connecting across the mountain range, the Canterbury Range. And the earthquakes are progressing down to the south, and they're getting larger and larger and larger. And as it happens, again, the big one that hit several months ago at this point, that big earthquake itself was preceded by a large earthquake to the north of the island. So right on the north part, or what I call the catcher's mitt, the tip of the north part of the island, was struck by a 7.0 earthquake. It was the day that Animatronic, the guy who makes all my animations, the day he landed down in Wellington is the day the 7 hit on the North Island. Then, a few months later, I want to say it was a month and a half later, then the big one hit on the South Island, and that was the big one that caused so much damage. The 7 to the north did cause a shakeup on the north part of the island, but not nearly like the one that struck on land, which was, again, several months ago itself. Since then, earthquakes have spread out down to the south and gone, reached all the way across the island. And now I'm seeing, I did miss something down here to the south, the 4.5. There is a 4.5 on here. Hold on, when is that showing as hitting? Was that the previous? No, it's listed as 3:15, so I guess that's last night. A 4.5 hit on the south part of the island? Is that right? How did we miss that last night? Did it just get populated on the feed today? That's really interesting. Okay, so the south part of the island was struck by a 4.5. I wonder what the information on this is. Hold on. I didn't get to check this out. Somehow I missed this. Let's go to the origin page, go to the magnitude list, and see what our details are. 4.6, low end 4, dragging it down, but I see it's already 4.7s detected, 4.7s topping out at 4.7. So a near 5, mid-range 4 to near 5.0 struck the south part of the island last night. Well, that changes everything. Well, check it out, guys. The south part of the island was already struck last night, and then the north part of the island was struck today. Well, that means the central part of the island is going to be hit next. This is like a shell game. You ever see those, the three shells, and you move them around? Okay, normally it's the middle point that's hit first, then the north, then the south. But this time, south was hit first, then the north. Now the middle, I believe, would be the next point. And it's only going to be pretty much like what struck down at the south part of the island, between a 4.5 and a 4.7. Not just anywhere at the middle, right here south of the red line, south of Kiakoura, southwest of there, let's say by about 30 or 40 miles, maybe at the most, south-southwest, or maybe due west, of Kiakoura. Mispronouncing it? Doesn't matter. You know where I'm talking about. Okay, so that's our New Zealand update. Now we need to go further over to the west. Check this out. South Indonesia going up into Philippines, struck by a swarm of fours and fives spreading out across about 1,500 miles from North Philippines down to the 5.0 down to the south. Notice where they all struck. Right on our red arrows, or right next to them at this point where our arrow points in. Okay, you can see the cleft V shape that goes into the actual ridge here. The red arrow is set slightly out from it, so it doesn't get in the way of that seeing the actual formation in the crust. But okay, so right on the tip of there, 4.3, down to the south, near 5.0, in between all of these, we have volcanic eruptions occurring. Right here at our letter V, Dukono erupted again, and Sinabung erupted again yesterday. We can quickly consult our volcano discovery feed, and this is going to lead us into other news that happened today, for instance, over at Mount Etna, and I'll get into that in a second. But Dukono, the West Pacific is again showing large activity developing out, flight level 7,000 feet, 10,000 feet high blasts, Dukono, Bagana, Abrim, which others? Dukono again, and Dukono again, and Sinabung. Okay, Sinabung also on the list. Let me show you where Sinabung is. Sinabung is right here. So basically, we have three sets of eruptions over here on the West Pacific. Now, if you look at the other half of the list there that I kind of skipped over, you're going to see the East Pacific swarming out big time. So Reventador, and swarming out with eruptions. So Reventador in Ecuador erupting, Nevados del Chilean in Chile, Sabancaya in Peru, Reventador again in Ecuador, Nevados del Chilean again. You see this? So both sides struck by three sets of eruptions with nothing in the North Pacific at all. No eruptions at Chvaletice, no eruptions at Bogoslav, no eruptions at Kluchevskoye. Chvaletice is over here where our letter V is, on the Kamchatka Peninsula, and Bogoslav is up here in Alaska where our letter V is. I would say at this point, there's going to be a big blast up here to the north. Whether it's at Bogoslav or Chvaletice or Kluchevskoye, I don't forecast eruptions. I can just tell you, there's going to be a big blast. Big one. Because we have both sides of the Pacific going, and normally there's a fulcrum point up here in the middle. So if one side's showing three eruptions, three large sets of eruptions, the other side's showing three sets of large eruptions, there should be something up here in the middle that goes. And it should be big. Over 25,000 foot high blast, that kind of stuff. Okay, now let's get into the United States and Europe. Which should we do first? Let's do Europe really quick. So Europe, you guys, we saw a new set of earthquakes develop out over here in Western Iran on the plate boundary. We saw a new swarm of earthquakes develop out between Turkey and Crete. Crete is the island down here to the south. And guys, it was struck last night as expected. We told you that right in between Crete and Turkey. Well, look to the north. See this? Obviously, we look to the north and it's a swarm of earthquakes that's broke out in our expected area. All twos, a few threes. And if you add this all together with the 4.3 that struck yesterday, it means there's new incoming pressure down into South Italy and going across over to Gibraltar. And lo and behold, look what was struck over the past day. We saw a new swarm breakout down in Sicily, multiple new eruptions at Mount Etna, and that leads me into the story that I have saved right here. Many people probably heard about it today, but I'm going to go ahead and play this for you.
All of a sudden there was a first explosion that went up of steam. That didn't seem too bad, but it was really the second explosion that threw up all of those boiling rocks. You have to remember that magma is more than 1,000 degrees Celsius in temperature. Boulders going up, steam going up too, and everyone just started to run, but you couldn't really see. It was almost a total whiteout because of the steam in front of you, but luckily we managed to make it to a vehicle that was able to take us safely back down the mountain. But there were injuries there, luckily not too serious. Cuts, burns and some bruises too, and a guide dislocated his shoulder. But we were told we were extremely lucky. The volcanologist who was with us said it was one of the most dangerous incidents that he'd actually seen in his 30-year career in studying Etna. So we were lucky to get out, a narrow escape.
Now, what responsible volcanologist would allow for people to go up on the flanks of an erupting volcano, especially close enough that, look, I mean, this is why professionals and everyone else that's listening right now need to pay attention to what's going on in the areas adjacent to, for instance, Italy, South Italy, where Etna is. Well, do you think the volcanologist would take a team of media people and tourists up there if they knew that there was incoming pressure that had just struck down near Crete, and that the pressure was going to divide, half going to the north up into Romania and the other half coming down into South Italy, that it might not be a prudent move to not go up on that volcano during that time? Right? I mean, it's like ignoring. Look, would you go mountain climbing when there's an incoming gale force storm coming? Would you climb to the top of Mount Everest in the middle of a blizzard? Would you go surfing in a hurricane? That's the question. And it's a redundant question. It's a question I already know. It's a rhetorical question that I already know the answer to, which is no, you shouldn't. So there's incoming pressure into South Italy. Same time that's going on, look what else hit, guys. 3.0 earthquake, 2.9, struck near the English Channel in North France. Or on West France, Northwest France. And the English Channel is right here. And the earthquake struck just south of there. Very close enough. And that's the magnitude, the exact magnitude we said to watch for. Same time that's going on, new swarm broke out in Switzerland and a new little earthquake struck up here to the north in North Italy. But what I'd say overall is that the pressure is transferring out across Europe. It's pretty obvious. Going up to the west-northwest. And as we told you, we would see new activity down near Gibraltar. But there hasn't been any activity yet in between at the Spain-France border, and I would expect it to strike within the next 48 hours. So it's going to be similar in size to what struck down here near Crete. So if it's a 4.3 or so, we should look for a 3.9 to 4.0 to be striking at the Spain-France border, and then follow-up movement, lesser in the 3 range, going all the way out to our letter X. So expect that to happen within the next 48 hours. Same time all that's going down, look what happened up here to the north. Iceland has struck, and the North Gackle Ridge was struck, and these are two volcanic centers, but they were struck by threes. The reason they were struck by threes is because of the threes to the south. Transferring out and across, we told you watch the English Channel, then we told you to watch Iceland, right? Well, English Channel was hit, or very close to that, and then a direct hit right on the letter X in Iceland. This leads me into the good old US of A. Now, last night we talked about this. The New Madrid seismic zone was struck by a rather rare 3.6 earthquake. And it's more rare, or rarer, than what we see happen to the west all the time. 3.6 is, well, child's play over here to the west. The reason that we saw activity strike in the New Madrid seismic zone overall is because of the activity coming from the west-northwest, all the way up here off the coast of the United States going into Canada. And this brings me into what we're going to watch for over the next several days here off the coast of the United States. All the warning signs are here right now. If you want to see warning signs, if you live on the West Coast, I'm going to tell you, I hope you're listening, a longtime viewers, you hear me say it every night, but this is for the new people. The warning signs that show up for you guys are threefold. One, the first thing that starts happening is your dormant volcanoes start to swarm. They start showing stacks of earthquakes happening at these ancient volcanoes. Not a sign of an eruption, but a sign of pressure. Second thing that starts happening, you start seeing swarms of earthquakes happen at your pumping operations. geothermal, gas, and oil, all three start moving. Then, finally, you start to see shallow movement right along the major fault zones that you're all familiar with. And you'll see those areas connected. Once they connect, all three areas are inundated with pressure, saturated with pressure. The pressure has nowhere to go from there, so it tries to seek a way out. In this case, it tries to seek a way out over to the east, but it's met by the Intermountain West, the huge edge of the craton. And if the pressure stops there, which is what's happening right now, it builds back up here to the west-northwest and strikes off the coast. So in other words, this area becomes saturated, the pressure has nowhere to go, and it instantly backfills, and it strikes off the coast to the west-northwest. And there's a great force out there right now, at least equal to several 4.0 earthquakes, maybe even a 5, to be consistent with everything else around the plate. And it's building between Vancouver and the coast of northwest coast of California, where the Gorda Escarpment is. Gorda Escarpment is this east and west facing ridge. It's kind of shadowy right there. And then the Z-shaped structure there, or the S-shaped structure, is the Juan de Fuca Fracture Zone. And the Cascadia Subduction Zone is also in that zone. So, overall, where are we seeing earthquakes right now, today? Well, we're seeing stacks of earthquakes happen at our volcanoes, at your pumping operations, and along the fault zones. And I'm going to prove that to you right now, starting up here to the north. Pretty much the larger, or the one of the largest earthquakes of the day, striking up in Northern California at a place called Shingletown, 17 kilometers depth. Well, USGS does not show you the appropriate information that I think they should. And let's just take you in and show you. Excuse me. Okay, so here we go. You're going to see we are on the edge of a very large volcanic field. Now, Mount Lassen is right here. It's the famous volcano. It erupted about 100 years ago, sent off a big blast. But all these other smaller buttes, every single one of these is an old volcano. And I can just prove it to you. Like, see this lava flow here? See how this lava flow? This is a lava flow, by the way. It's not like a rock slide or something. Let me bring it in an angle to show it to you a little bit better. Okay, we'll bring this in, and you'll see this goes back to a cone or a cinder right here. So this cinder erupted in the past, and it sent off those lava flows going down here to the south. And it's a pretty big eruption that happened maybe several hundred years ago. I mean, if you take a look at it, you see there's no trees. There's trees on some parts of it, but again, there's other buttes here. So these are past, much older, the tumble buttes north and south. See, we have another lava flow going up here to the north, coming off of Hall Butte, which is another cinder cone right there. And it just keeps going. I mean, look at these. Look at the cinder. Look at this lava flow here. This lava flow here goes back and traced back to Cinder Buttes North, which is made up of multiple small cinders, each one a cone in itself, each one erupting in the past. And this happens over and over and over again. That's why there's hundreds of these here, guys. The reason there's hundreds of these here, pressure builds here and releases here. And when there's great pressure off the coast, guess what? It leads to great pressure interior to the coast within a short amount of time. So that's the 3.0, the largest earthquake of the day, striking there. Then we go south and you'll see the big stack of earthquakes. We can grab the coordinates on any one of these. USGS are listed as a place called the Geysers. Well, that should just give away the name, but we'll go look it up. It's on the flanks of Clear Lake Volcano. Clear Lake Volcano is a large volcano, and Smithsonian designated here with the red triangle. See that? Go ahead and pause it and read it if you'd like to see the information. It hasn't erupted in thousands of years, but we zoom in on the area where the earthquake is, and you'll see there's a geothermal pumping operation here, where humans have drilled down into the earth. They inject water. The water is then extracted and steamed off and taken off in pipes that go up to turbine stations, such as this. And these turbines spin and provide electricity for the region. They got a whole bunch of these all over the hillsides. That's just one. They got another one at the hilltop here. Several more back down in the valley down here. So they put these in strategic places to catch the steam. And this is the larger volcano there, Clear Lake Volcano. And that is a past blast caldera, by the way, guys. So swarms there. Then we go south and we'll go over to the east first. And we'll talk about the swarm that's happening here. See this? Two big clusters of earthquakes. And I'm going to pull the coordinates on the ones to the north first. Then we're going to go look down to the south. See this? Southwest of Hawthorne, Nevada. Again, not a very descriptive, description. Now, I'm interested in this because there's a cause for each one of these guys. These are your warning signs. Now, I'm showing you in depth so that you can do this yourself. You can start looking up the earthquakes real easy. Real easy. Just grab the coordinates from the USGS page and put them in on Google Earth. And you'll see that most of these earthquakes have a cause. In this case, the swarm is happening on the flanks of Aurora Crater, which is still lined with black obsidian and black basalt. And you can see the old chunky lava flows that extended off this. And next to it, Mud Springs Volcanic Butte. That's not a mud flow. This is several hundred feet high off the desert floor. And again, it's black basalt, old lava flows. And we have a swarm striking there. Now there's also a swarm down to the south. And let's pull those coordinates. We'll just grab any one of them. Each one is just a swarm of microquakes, but the microquakes let us know something's coming. Something great, something's displacing all these ancient magma chambers that are somewhat hardened down in the crust. So we'll put our coordinates in there. You'll see we're going to jump right across Mono Lake Supervolcano, and we'll be brought down on the flanks of Mammoth Mountain and the Long Valley Caldera. Mammoth Mountain is here. It's a famous ski resort, but it's also a Smithsonian-marked volcano. And I said Mono Lake Supervolcano because that's exactly what this is. It's about half the size of Yellowstone, but there it is, Smithsonian designation. Go ahead and read that. So a swarm happening down here at the Long Valley Caldera, which we will also click on. You can read that. Long Valley Caldera consists of dozens of cone volcanoes, glass flows, just to show you another example of a old cone cinder that's been covered in trees, letting you know how old that is. Doesn't even have a real name to it. I guess you just call it part of the Long Valley Caldera. So that's where the second swarm is, down to the south. So both of those are volcanic. Then you're going to see another swarm over here in western San Joaquin Valley with the other borderline largest earthquake of the day. It started out at 3.1 and then was elevated to 3.3. The other one started out at 3.3 and was downgraded to 3.1. So it's kind of a flip-flop on that. It doesn't really matter. It's within a few points. But let me show you where it struck. Zooming in on that area, you'll see we're going into a farm field. Well, you got to look within a few miles of the farm field, and what you're going to make out is one of the largest pumping operations in California. And I'll prove that to you so you don't have to take my word for it. Starting over here to the west-northwest, we have thousands of wells. And when I zoom in at this point, they probably just look like ants on the ground to you if you have them full screen. So let me bring them in real close so you can see the shadows on these, and then you'll start to say, dang, really? Okay. So many of these. And it goes all the way over here up to the north, down to the south, where it even picks up even in more number. And then we go over here, we skip across this little valley by about a mile or two, and we pick back up over here with more pads. You see these? And I won't waste your time showing you all the pads, but again, every single one of these is a different oil well. I'm going to zoom in real close. Again, shadow tells the tale of what we're looking at here. And it just carries on. It goes all the way across this whole range here, and it goes back down to the south, and it stops right next to, and then it picks back up on the other side. This range here, also a large pumping operation connected by pipelines. Again, more of the same. And we've got our pipelines that connect through. So you can trace them back if you're really an enterprising person and you get bored or something. Come in here and take a look. You won't believe it. And so there we go. We got our swarm striking right between the two oil patches. And that's a sign. It's a sign that pressure is inundating all of California. And I haven't even touched on Southern California yet. But let's go. Let's carry on. Going down to the south even further, we have another cluster of earthquakes. This is in the South Long Valley, and I already showed you the Long Valley place mark for the volcanoes. Well, I guess I should just show this to you as well. It becomes time-consuming, really. Look, we're already 30 minutes in, and I have to show each location, but it speaks of volumes. The Coso Volcanic Field is being hit, again, by another swarm. And each one of these is an old cinder as well. And Smithsonian marked, so you don't have to take my word for it. And then our greater volcanoes, our younger volcanoes. Volcano peak. Volcano peaks is what it should be called, because each one of these is a different eruptive spot. You can see each cone that's developed over time. It's going to happen again some point in the future, but it's not going to happen now, thank God. So we get down to the south, and we just have a couple more to go, right? We have a couple more till we get to this big cluster around Salton Sea. Well, let's go into Los Angeles. Let's go check this sucker out, see what's there. Moore Park, California. That looks to me like it's in downtown L.A. And the depth on that, 17 kilometers deep, deeper than any man-made operation I know of, or maybe it isn't. Let's go see. Okay, where are we here? Here we are, and it looks, north of Los Angeles. North of Los Angeles. What do we have north of Los Angeles? Oh, here we go. One of the larger Southern California oil pumping operations. Starting here in Ventura, look how close together these are. Each one of these is drilled out. So they've drilled out thousands of feet down into the crust. And there it is, okay. So it's not just here. It goes across the highway and carries on over to the east. See all these? And just like we were looking at in San Joaquin Valley, they're just placed all over the place, so much so that, you know, it really makes you wonder why the hell they're doing all this pumping and extraction nearby. So we just carry on over to the east along the range, and guys, it's right here on the other side of the range. I mean, we always look within 6 to 10 miles, so let's just get a good eye. Maybe that's more than 6 miles. Look, it's 6 to 8 miles away. We always look, the USGS always looks within 6 miles in Oklahoma or anywhere else. And we always look within 6 to 10 miles, because that's what I've seen there being effect on when it comes to pumping operations. So the real question is are there any others mixed in here that I'm just missing? I mean, we've got orchards here, but we know mixed in with all the orchards and the clear planting that they do oil and pumping operations. I'll have to inspect the area a little bit closer, see if there's anything of any significance here, because it looks like we're coming in on some mansions. Now, they did build a lot of these new subdivisions over the past 20 and 30 years in California on top of old oil fields, because all of North Los Angeles going up this way was a huge pumping operation back in the 20s and 30s. It went on for miles, and they drilled thousands of feet even back then. So the real question is, are there any other nearby wells to this location? I'll have to do some inspecting, but it's already close enough. The biggest pumping operations are again within just a few miles to the north. So that's where the two is striking. A little bit over to the east. Well, I guess we can just go quickly look and see what's a little bit over to the east. Well, let's get the coordinates on this. San Fernando, California. Okay, well, let's just be accurate and put in the actual coordinates, see where it takes us. Well, there's San Fernando, and how many miles away is our pumping operation? I mean, obviously, we've got a fracking oil and drilling pumping operation here. Wonderful again. Oh, no, geothermal, too. Look at that. We've got geothermal. Looks like we also have fracking, oil, and drilling. And geothermal. All of them going on at once here. Geothermal. Geothermal? Why would there be geothermal there? Isn't it an old volcano? Why would there be geothermal here? What is this? Mission Point? Never heard of it. Normally you do geothermal on the flanks of a volcano. As a matter of fact, that's the only spots you do geothermal, large geothermal pumping operations. Why have I never caught that before? Well, regardless, there it is, right here to the south, within just a few miles. Definitely close enough to be related, and it's definitely a sign that we're looking for at least a swarm of fours, maybe even a five, to strike off the coast, most likely of Northwest California. If I were to lean towards a spot that's going to strike at this point, I'm changing my warning area from the north portion to the south portion, because something very close to California, it might go up onto Oregon. So that's a few hundred miles. That's actually a pretty large warning area. But a swarm of fours, nobody will feel it. Okay, so we're not worried about big waves or anything like that. It's just going to be consistent with the other 4s and 5s striking around the plate right now, which you see marked out here on the globe. South America, Central America, West Pacific, Southwest Pacific, even going over towards Asia, going into the Middle East, all struck by swarms of 4s going into 5s. Which means, logically, unless Boguslav erupts to relieve some of that pressure, if Boguslav erupts, it might relieve some of the pressure, but right now, it's already crept over towards Alaska, and it's been silent off the coast to the west-northwest. So long-term, I'm going to give you guys a 2 to 3 week outlook for the northwest based upon that slow slip event that they announced was going on. I didn't just announce this. Professionals announced there was a slow slip event happening in the west-northwest of the United States in the Olympic Peninsula next to Seattle. And what we're going to do right now is we're going to put Seattle on a 3 week watch. Now, this is a perfect time for you to talk to your friends, your family, your loved ones, your coworkers, a perfect time to develop a plan, even if nothing hits. But the professionals announced that a slow slip event was occurring. You can go check the Pacific Northwest Seismic Network. I won't be taking you there for many personal reasons between Professor John Vidali and I, but you guys can go there and see it. Search the earthquakes for the last month in Washington, and you will see it, and you'll see the spot, and it's just west of Seattle. And the past slow slip events that have happened, 2012, perfect example. Back in 2012, in September, there was a slow slip event that happened off the coast of Vancouver, BC. It was about the same size as the slow slip event that's happening here off the east coast of the Olympic Peninsula in Washington. And in 2012, starting in September, it went on for about 4 or 5 weeks, maybe even 6 weeks, into October, let's just say. So starting into September, going throughout all of September, going into October, then the slow slip event started to die out. On October 27th, 2012, that's when a 7.7 earthquake struck just to the north of the slow slip location, just to the north of Vancouver Island, up here in this inlet right here. And it was a big earthquake, caused a small tsunami. Luckily, it struck out to sea, and luckily, it didn't cause much damage. But now that the slow slip event's happening here east of the Olympic Peninsula, in between Seattle and the Olympic Peninsula, right there in that body of water, that bay, I don't have the name of it, let's go get it. It's happening right in here, east of Seattle, across Bainbridge Island, Puget Sound. Okay, is that what it's called? Is that Puget Sound? Oh, it comes all the way down there, really? Okay. Okay, Puget Sound, it's happening across this area, west of Seattle. And you can talk to your friends, family, and loved ones, say, look, they've all been telling us about watching for the big one. Well, it's not going to be the big 9.0. The chances of it being the big 9 are slim. There's several reasons why. One, the slow slip event isn't big enough. There aren't a whole bunch of 4s and 5s striking in there. Like back in 2011, there was a slow slip event happening over in Japan, and it was slow slipping in 4s and 5s, not 1s and 2s and 3s. Okay? So it was just a steady stream of 4s and 5s and 4s and 5s over the course of a month, leading up to the big one in Japan in 2011. And 2 days before the big one, there was a 7 mixed in there, a 7.2. So it was going 4, 5, 4, 5, 4, 5, then 7, boom, then 2 days later, the big, big one hit. So we're not talking about the big, big one. We're talking about just a big one. What's the difference? Well, the big, big one is like what happened over in Japan, and it causes huge tsunamis, and it causes major, major devastating destruction. But a big one is like what we're talking about maybe in the 90s in California. Now, that could be the result of the slow slip event. It happened in 2012. It happened over in Japan in 2011. Usually, these slow slip events are followed by larger earthquakes. Now, we hope for less. You can always hope for less. What if it's only followed by a 5.5 or something? Yeah, it's enough to knock things off shelves. Yeah, it's enough to break windows and maybe cause cracks in the pavement. But it's not enough to cause devastating damage. It's enough to scare people, but enough not to cause death and destruction. Okay? Well, that's what you hope for. but you plan for something similar to what happened in 2012. So in that 7 range. Now, what's the time frame on that? According to the documentaries we watched and I played here on my stream multiple times in the past couple weeks, and I'll do it again. Maybe I'll do it again tomorrow. Maybe after tomorrow night's update, I will play the documentaries, or maybe all day tomorrow. I will play the documentaries on the slow slip event, and you can listen to the professionals talk about what the turnaround time is for after the slow slip event stopping and the big ones hitting. Usually, it's only a couple weeks, sometimes less. So the slow slip event is carrying on right now. You can see it. Over the past several days, there's been a couple more threes mixed in up here, reaching over towards Yellowstone, striking Mount St. Helens, striking in the Puget Sound, striking to the west-northwest near Vancouver Island. So it's there. I mean, we have to talk about this and not be alarmist. Let me remind you, the 9.0 over in Japan in 2011, it didn't knock down skyscrapers even close to the epicenter. And yeah, there were tall buildings. There was 5 and 6 story high buildings. They didn't collapse. People's houses stayed up in the 9. The big damage was caused by the wave. Now, yeah, there were stone structures. If you had a stone structure, you're in like a cinder block house or a brick house or a concrete house of some kind. Well, you need to know what to do when an earthquake above 5.0 hits. You really do. Anything above a mid-range 5 in a stone structure is enough to cause at least cracking and breakage, sometimes moderate collapse. Especially on the front of the house, like a facade or brick front that could fall off the house. So you need to know what to do. Your kids need to know what to do. Your co-workers and your employees certainly need to know what to do, because you don't want to be left managing that on top of trying to manage a situation already, right? People in panic. So it's like preparing for a fire drill. It's like preparing for a storm drill. So you don't need, I would say, you don't need huge stockpiles of food and water. What are you going to do? Put it on a pallet and jack it around? I mean, so you need to know what to do when the earthquake strikes. And you need to have some plans for what to do afterwards, communication especially. Communication will be your lifeline to trying to get help or to trying to get something that you need, okay? So you know what your situation is better than I do. All I can tell you is to have that plan and be prepared. And we're going to do it for the next 3 weeks. They are on a 3-week watch as of tonight. So 3 weeks from now, where does that put us? That puts us to April 6th. So by April 6th, if nothing's hit, we will completely cancel the whole watch, and that's where we'll leave it. But on these slow slip type events, when I don't have all the information that I would want, and I'm going by what other professionals are saying, I'm putting that cap on it. Why 3 weeks? Well, the last time it took about a week and a half to 2 weeks for a large earthquake to hit after the slow slip event stopped. So I'm going to give it another week for the slow slip event to keep calming down, keep getting less and less, and then look for the large earthquake to hit within 2 weeks from that point. So I don't normally do anything over 7 days, 7 to 10 day forecasts. So this is going far beyond anything that I would normally issue a forecast for. And again, I'm basing it upon the professionals' talk on this, not my own. Okay? So don't panic, but prepare for a potential of up to a 7.0. You hope it'll be half that. But the chances of nothing happening, when the last several times we've seen slow slip events happen, they have been followed by somewhat larger earthquakes. Now, they say it happens every year, the slow slip event up in the Northwest. Well, is it any coincidence that almost every single year we do see swarms of 5s and a few 6s strike up there? Are they coinciding with these slow slip events that aren't as major as what's going on now? Yes, most likely. Just by deduction purposes, I would say yes, that that's probably related. Now, study would probably indicate that, but I don't have time to do that here on the live stream. Maybe I'll make that a point to try and run that information down over the next couple weeks. Overall, I want you to take a look at the globe. Take a look at the last 7 days of earthquakes. Now, this is reported from multiple agencies, and we've got the duplicates turned off. So you can clearly see it moved exponentially again. And when we look at the 5.0s and greater, you'll see where our preponderance of those type of earthquakes strike. They start in the West Pacific, spread out from that point, and they lose steam as they go outwards from the West Pacific. Now look at our 4.0s and greater. So it spreads out and goes all the way out to the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. Starts with greater movement here, spreads out all the way following these red lines, the plate boundaries. We put them on the map for a reason. You can see where the earthquakes strike. Very few of the earthquakes strike outside of our red lines, our plate boundaries. In general, they follow like a roadmap around the planet. The only thing that stops the pressure is the release of the pressure. Does that make logical sense to any child listening? Okay, in order for the pressure to stop, it has to be released. Well, it releases in earthquakes and eruptions along the way on its travels across the planet. And that's why we're watching. You can see there's one spot on the whole planet, high and dry, from 4 and 5.0 earthquake activity over the last 7 days. Gee, where is it? You ever see on one of those child shows, one of these things is not like the other? Well, one of these things is not like the other. There is a spot that should be filled in. And we have to watch there for the next 72 hours, 3 days maybe. It shouldn't take long. It shouldn't take that long for this area to be filled in. Okay? So have your plans dusted off, guys. Have your plans dusted off. If you don't have plans in the Northwest, like I said, it's probably a good time for you to actually do that, finally. And people talk about it all the time, but now you got a good reason, and you've got a scientific reason to tell your friends and family that even if nothing strikes after the end of this slow slip, the chances of nothing striking are slim because the past several slow slip events were followed by larger movement, larger than any of the other earthquakes that struck during the whole slow slip event. Sometimes, and I'd say maybe, at least from my observation, that sometimes the total amount of earthquakes that strike during that slow slip event, let's say it's several thousand ones and twos that strike, zeros, ones, and twos. Those several thousand zeros and ones and twos can add up to a 6 or a 6.5 or a 7. So cumulatively, you'll see an area move slow slip-wise, slowly slipping, and then finally, compensation. And that's what I'm worried about. So better for me to worry about it and talk about it and for you to prepare for it than to not worry about it, not talk about it, ignore it, and hope that it goes away. I don't know very many things that just go away, when you ignore them at least. So, okay, so much love to everybody. And thank you to everybody who's donated to my fundraiser. Again, operations, pay the bills, pay the rent, no fancy clothes, no new cars. Well, not that you can get a car for $3,000, but none of that. It's strictly to keep me here and to pay everything that I need to pay, since YouTube is so far this month, $200. $200 all month on YouTube. Isn't that crazy? All right, guys. Peace out. And one other thing. I got a stack of stuff at the P.O. box again today. I guess I'm going to have to do an opening because this is a lot of stuff. I mean, we're talking letters. Let me just quickly tell you. We got something from New Zealand. Yep, got something from New Zealand, something from Oregon, and a big box from Italy. And it says on the outside, what on the customs declaration, what's on the outside? And it says Italian beer gifts. Italian beer, and it's heavy. It's a heavy box. So, I think I'm just going to have to open some stuff tonight, guys. But, I mean, we got all kinds of stuff. We got something from Simi Valley, California, Bend, Oregon, Rapid City, South Dakota, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, San Antonio, Texas, Minneapolis, Minnesota, Santa Ana, California, Portland, Oregon, another Minneapolis, Minnesota, and Corona, California. And then boxes, too. So we'll do it. Let's just do it after midnight. I'll do the same thing. Maybe 12, 1230. I'll come back in and we'll have a beer and we will open these suckers up and answer the questions that are inside. Cool, guys. Word up. Peace out.